mean? Peace. Shalom, the word shalom, comes from the Torah, which means peace. Shalom in, it also means shalem, means complete. Shalem means that to achieve peace, we need to be complete. The reason why the Jewish people are in Israel is not because of the Balfour Declaration or the UN. The reason why the Jewish people are in Israel is simply because Hashem, God the Almighty, the Creator of the universe, gave the land of Israel to the Jewish people.
Well, backing that up,
right.
We have all this historical precedent.
Right.
And all this legal precedent, so that people who don't respect the fact that we have the biblical entitlement, they should respect the other.
Right. The Bible is the blueprint, the Torah is the blueprint of creation. We Jewish people, and for that matter, non-Jewish people, believe in the Bible, or believe in God. Now, the Torah gave God gave the Torah to the Jewish people. It's interesting that the three cities, the Shomron, we're talking about the Shomron, or for that matter, one of the cities in the Shomron, or Judah, Judah of Shomron, is called the holy city of Hebron. Hebron is a resting place of the first Adam and Eve, and Abraham and Sarah, and Isaac, and so on. It's interesting that the Shomron, or the Hebron, it was the first place in the Bible where it's actually recorded where Abraham actually paid top dollar. If you want to look at the first real estate transaction in the world that took place, it took place in Hebron, where Abraham needed a place, where his wife passed away. He needed a place, and he went to, and first they said they want to give it to him. He said, no, I'm not interested in the fact that you want to give it to me. I want to pay for it. The reason being is because, you know, he realized that you want to own something, nothing comes for free.
Mm-hmm.
And God gave God, the creator of the universe, gave the land of Israel to the Jewish people. Abraham bought this land. He bought it cash, cold, you know, hard cash. And it's crazy to think that the entire world is focused on the Shomron, or Yehuda v'Shomron. And he said, we have a legitimate right to live there.
Yes, well, we're very well aware of the legitimacy of it. But the thing is that the world is hooked on the definitions. You know, even the word settlement requires definition. David, I'd love you to talk a little bit about the settlement that you live in, Kfar Tapuach, and the other settlements that you deal with, and what makes this issue about the legality and illegality so critical.
I just want to add that the idea of a settlement, what a settlement means an outpost. Or the entire Israel is one land.
Well, the Jews settled in Israel, right? Tel Aviv was settled 100 years ago.
Settlement implies there's a settlement. David, I'd like you to comment on that, the idea of a settlement.
I live in a town called Kfar Tapuach, which is in the heartland of the land of Israel. It's right in the center, the heart of the land of Israel, the historical homeland of the Jewish people. All of the locations that we read about in the Bible, all of the historical locations that our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, visited going through the land of Israel, are all located in Yehuda and in Shomron. That is the historical homeland of the Jewish people. The essence of Zionism, the essence of returning to our land, returning to the land of Israel, is all based on the God-given right, on the fact that the Torah, the Bible, states that God promised this land to our people. But not only that, throughout history, the Jewish people dwelt on that land. When Joshua, in the Bible, brought the Jewish people into the land of Israel, the first place that they gathered was between two mountains, between Har Gerizim, Mount Gerizim, and Mount Ebal, at the site of the city of Shechem, the biblical city, that was also purchased by Yaakov Avinu, by our father. And Joseph, the son of
Jacob,
is buried there in Shechem. The Jewish people stood there between two mountains and swore that they would uphold the mitzvot, the commandments of the Torah. And going on that same road, if you look at a modern map, a road map of the state of Israel, route number 60 on the map takes us through all of those historical biblical locations. Every one of them is on that same road. Shechem, Shiloh, Bet El, Jerusalem, Bethlehem, Hebron, and Beersheba are all situated on the 60 route. My hometown, Kfar Tzipoch, is also located on that same route. And that route, the 60 road, the way of our fathers, the highway of the Bible, is the center of the Jewish culture. Jews lived there up until the time that our people were exiled forcefully by the Roman imperialist army, who captured our land, who fought our armies, and took over our land and forced us out of the land. But for 2,000 years, while our people were dispersed throughout the nations, Jews in every location in the world would face Jerusalem and pray three times a day, and many would get up in the middle of the night to cry, to return, to rebuild our holy city of Jerusalem. All of those locations, with Jerusalem in the center, are all located in those same areas that are politically called the West Bank.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you say that the three cities which were actually purchased was Shechem by Jacob, Abraham purchased Hebron, and King David purchased Jerusalem and established it.
And King David, of course, was in Hebron too.
Right, right. But
for 8 years, I think.
He purchased Jerusalem. And the three cities that seem to be the most contested, it's so ironic that these three cities actually were purchased by the patriarchs.
Yes, actually, you know, it's not ironic. When you travel through Israel, what you see, and I've been going there for many chizuk trips now, maybe 30 over the last few years, and you see that all the most precious places that the Jews have entitlement to, somehow they become very precious to the Arabs also. You know, even Jerusalem, right now they're talking about dividing Yerushalayim. And of course we feel that would be a great sin. But when you travel around and you look at Jerusalem, you see that in effect, the Arabs have taken over a very strong hold there. And when it was in Arab hands between 48 and 67, were there any Arab leaders who visited there? Was there any claim to the land? No. The synagogues and churches were destroyed. The place was treated like a garbage dump.
It's interesting you say that the actual place, you know, that the actual place, the Jerusalem and the Holy Land, all these holy cities, it's interesting that the entire world is focused on this little piece of land called Israel, Eretz Yisrael. Why is it? You know, you think a second. It's about the size of New Jersey. It doesn't have any oil. It's only because that Hashem, the divine light, the divine godliness, shines so bright that it's being contested. Jerusalem being the Yerushalayim, the holy city, it's being contested. Only because of the fact that these lands are holy. And the fact of the matter is that it says that we're coming up now to 3 weeks, and it says that God created a temple in Jerusalem. The temple in Jerusalem stood as a beacon of light for all nations. During the time of Solomon, the King Solomon, and during the time that actually everyone came to Jerusalem to pay tribute, to bring up sacrifices, to pray to the God of Israel, of the which is the Hashem, the Almighty. And it's interesting that now the entire world is focused on this land. And instead of realizing that this is a land that God, by miraculous circumstances, gave it to the Jewish people, instead of protecting it and preserving it and realizing that Jerusalem should be in the hands of the Jewish people, because that's what God wanted when he gave us the 67 war with open miracles, when he gave us this opportunity. So it's like a lighthouse which the Jerusalem, and for that matter the temple, the Torah, serves as a light to all nations. As it says, that God created the Beit HaMikdash, the temple in Jerusalem, to serve as a beacon of light for all people. And instead of protecting that light and saying, you know what, this is a light which is guiding all ships into port, and the Arabs should protect it, and Christians, everyone should protect it, because at the end of the day, it's a blessing for all people.
Yes.
And instead of that, we seem to be focusing, let's cut it up, piece it up, let's chop it down, this is mine. Take a step back for a second.
Right. You know what, I would like to talk to David a little bit about the fact that, we tend to blame, Americans tend to blame the Obama administration today for all the pressure that's being put on Israel to relinquish settlements and, of course, freezing settlements and all of that. But, David, when we were with you traveling through the Shomron, we saw lots of examples of where the Israeli government itself is making life very, very difficult for the people living in on some of what we call the outposts, and perhaps even in the established settlements themselves. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Helen, unfortunately, the Israeli government, or parts of the Israeli government, have not yet understood the greatness of being an independent state and the responsibility of being independent and protecting our land. And they still have this galut mentality, this diaspora mentality. They haven't yet fully understood the greatness of returning to our land and being independent. And they look towards the nations of the world for approval, to see that everything is okay, like a dog looking back to his master to see that his master is there with him. And that is very unfortunate, because we are a great nation. And we have returned to our land through incredible miracles. The phenomenon of the intergathering of the Jewish people from the diaspora, from the being spread out amongst the nations, returning to our land is a phenomenon that was never ever repeated throughout all of history. There was no nation that was banished from its land and spread out throughout the nations and accomplished the regrouping that the Jewish people have accomplished over the past near history, where Jewish people have come from Yemen and from Poland and from Morocco and from America and Russia and every different corner of the world. Jews have returned to the land of Israel and reestablished our nation and our culture. And my children go to nursery school and to high school and college, and kids who sit with them in the classroom are from all different backgrounds of the Jewish diaspora. And in our synagogue in Kfar Tapuach, we have Jews from every different place, from Peru and from Ethiopia and from Russia, and we all pray in the same prayer book. And this is an incredible miracle. The intergathering is a miracle. Winning the wars, being threatened by 22 Muslim countries that surround us and winning those wars is an incredible miracle. And the Six-Day War in 1967, returning to the heartland of our historical homeland, returning to the Temple Mount, returning the Temple Mount to Jewish rule is an incredible miracle. So our leadership need to acknowledge that, yes, we do have a great army, but in addition to that, we have a covenant with God, with the same God of the Bible who promised us the land, and we live in those miracles. And they need to take the strength from that belief and stand up to the pressures of the world. So I do agree with you. Of course, it's the pressure of the Obama administration on Israel to administer, if I can build an extra room onto my house, is incredibly outrageous.
Mm-hmm.
It's not acceptable anywhere else in the world. I don't hear presidents telling people of a Mexican background, you can't build homes in Southern California, or people from black people not to build homes because they're black. But the President of the United States has the goal to say Jewish people in the Jewish homeland cannot expand their houses, because there must be a settlement freeze.
And his Secretary of State underscores that, and she says the same thing, which of course is
it's totally outrageous. Mm-hmm. But it's outrageous. There's two sides of the coin, and both sides are wrong. Jews have the right to settle in the land of Israel. The land of Israel is our historical homeland.
It's amazing that a Jew could live anywhere. Could live in Berlin, could live in Moscow, could live in New York, could live anywhere. Where can't a Jew extend his house?
There are even Jews in Iraq.
In Iraq, you can't you can't extend your house if you're living in the Shamron. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
And we're talking about people which are living there, they're living peacefully, they're good neighbors, the Arabs are welcome to live there, and so on.
Well, the problem is, as David said, that, you know, there's something lacking in the spine of Israel's leaders that doesn't make them stand up against all this pressure. You know, we'd have an example in Honduras. They threw out their government and refused everybody. The United Nations came down on them, America came down on them, and they're just doing what they feel is right for them. And this is what countries have to do with dignity and pride. Yes.
It's interesting that the word shalom, like we said, is complete. If the Jewish people would be strong and complete and realize that the Torah is complete, the land is complete, the Shlemus Ha'am, Shlemus HaTorah, the Torah is complete, we would have peace. Mm-hmm. We would really have peace, and the entire world would be peace.
Yes.
And now what reflects in Israel reflects around the world. Mm-hmm. If the Jewish people around the world would be strong, we have to be strong in our Torah mitzvahs over here.
Yeah, but now you've touched on another very, very difficult subject, and that's the fact that there's so much disunity amongst the Jews.
We have, shockingly,
Jewish organizations that are in the mainstream of Jewish life that also seem to be confused about what our entitlements are, and what the land of Israel should mean to us, and what, you know, what it means to follow up on the Torah that tells us, you know, God says, go and take the land. This is the land that I promised to you and your forefathers, and so on. Why is it so hard for, you know, I don't understand. I don't understand all this Sinat Chinam, which destroyed the two temples, and now we're coming into the month of Av, and this is something to concern ourselves with also.
When God creates the world, he gives us free choice. And a free choice, by definition, is an equal balance. Equal balance. You have to do right, to do left. You can go right, left. The idea that there's so much animosity or so much negativity, or people don't know what to do, is because there's so much Kedusha, there's so much holiness. So there's an equal balance. Hashem, the most precious thing that Hashem wants from us is for us to choose the right thing. And everyone has the ability to make that choice. Even though sometimes it seems like it's insurmountable, like, oh wow, like I have all this. But the answer is, a person just has to make the effort, and Hashem will open the doors. You know, like Abraham, right?
Helen, I think that we have a responsibility to educate. Yeah. To educate our children, to educate ourselves, and to educate our neighbors. Recently, President of the United States, Mr. Obama, visited Cairo and made an address to the Muslim world. Right. And in his address to the Muslim world, he made a statement about the right of the Jewish people to have a state. And he connected that to the Holocaust. He said to the Muslims, you must agree, you must accept the fact that the Jewish people deserve a state because they were oppressed in Europe. And I want you to know that many people in Israel were offended by that statement. Many people said, what is he talking about? We deserve a state because of the Holocaust?
Well, but especially since there are so many Holocaust deniers. So if the Holocaust didn't happen, then Israel doesn't deserve a state. That's the whole foundation.
Incredibly, recently, Ahmadinejad, the Nazi ruler of Tehran, was interviewed by Mike Wallace on 60 Minutes. And he addressed that issue. He's a Holocaust denier.
Yes.
He said, I don't believe that there was a Holocaust. But he said, for argument's sake, let's say that there was a Holocaust in Europe. And the Jews deserve a state because there was a Holocaust. So why should it be in Palestine? Let it be in Germany.
Right.
So he taps into that argument.
Which is correct. He's 100% correct. The reason why the Jewish people belong or have the rights to live in Hebron, in Judea and Samaria, is not because of the Holocaust. It's simply because thousands of years ago, 5,669 years ago, God created the heaven and the earth. And he created the state, part of that heaven and earth is the state of Israel. And he gave it to the Jewish people, full stop, period. There's no other reason.
Right. So the Holocaust issue.
And when we just focus on that,
right.
Look into the Torah and focus on why are we there? Why don't we go to Nebraska or Florida or who knows where South Africa where the weather's not Australia go ahead.
I remember when one of the Knesset members was here and he took a trip to Colorado and he said, "Ah, what beautiful country. It's so huge."
Well, it is huge.
Why are we there?
It is huge and beautiful, yes. But the Jewish people have a little country. Rabbi Cohen said that Israel, correctly so, that Israel is the size of New Jersey. It's a tiny little country.
And we're there because...
In the midst of the Muslim world, it's like a postage stamp on a football field. It's so tiny and so small, and they want that too. They want that too. That's too much. That's incredible.
Well, that's very important also. All this discussion about the two-state solution, we know that, of course, that's a death sentence for Israel. But the very idea that you could take this tiny state of Israel and split it in half and quarters, because, of course, Gaza has to be contiguous with Judea and Samaria in this Palestinian state that they want to create, which would be totally absurd.
Look what happened with Gaza. Look what happened. We gave them, they gave away, didn't give back, they gave away a beautiful place where they were developing plants and fruit and so on. And look what happened. Look what happened. The rockets, it's only
We've never recovered from that,
I was there.
From
I was
that.
There with
and
non-Jewish people.
And I was there too.
And and I still can't believe it.
Yeah.
This is unbelievable. The fact that something like this happened, it's just crazy.
Yes.
It's just the fact that something like this happened is unbelievable. The fact that they gave away the land of Israel, Gush Katif.
Yeah, but there again, we have information that some of that happened because of divisions within our own Jewish people, and that it might have been stopped if we had been unified.
We need to learn from our history, and we seem to forget as things happen. We get involved in the next debate, and we forget about what happened before that. But if we briefly look over the recent history of the return of the Jewish people to the land of Israel, the British mandate was promised. The land of the British mandate was promised to the Jewish people to establish a Jewish homeland.
Right.
And we know that the map of the British mandate was much larger.
Yes.
Than the state of Israel, including the West Bank.
It included Jordan.
It included Jordan. And in 1922, the British, against the previous agreement...
Why are we arguing about politics over here? Or talking about politics?
No, because we want to establish, Rabbi, that it's not only a biblical entitlement, which, of course, is the overriding...
Right.
Issue and this is the most important thing that Hashem gave this to us.
But for people who are skeptical,
we have to show them that there is a history
that we keep reneging on what was promised to us.
Right.
The nations of the world agreed before the World War One to give us all to establish a Jewish state in all of the land of Israel. They gave two-thirds of that to the Jordanians.
David, let me interrupt you for a second, please, if I may. Let me ask you one simple question, and this should be the underlining factor in this entire negotiation, entire thinking. Did the fact of making peace resolve and end bloodshed, or did it increase bloodshed?
Well, we never made peace.
No, I'm saying...
The Arabs never made peace.
But did
since the beginning of the peace process, the situation has just become worse and worse.
For both sides. For Arabs, there's been more killings in Arab villages. There's been more killings in Israeli. Blood has been going from both sides. So let's forget about... Just to save human life, we should say, stop. Why are we touching the fire?
We don't have to say stop to the Israelis. I think we have to say stop to the Arabs.
Right.
It's the Arabs who are the impediments every step of the way. They could have had their state, and they could have had all of that, even in 1948, the UN partition, when the United Nations decided to divide it, and they went to war. Right. And they just keep going to war every time there's a possibility. And they walk out, Arafat walked out and slammed doors.
I think the idea of peace in the Middle East is really going to be achieved by everyone living happily and by not giving up land and not making more concessions.
Look, we have to recognize also that this is also a religious war for Islam.
Yeah.
And this prescribes certain things that people neglect to talk about. The Arab world, the Islamic Arab world, cannot accept Israel's presence in the Middle East because Israel is an infidel state. It cannot accept any dealings with infidels, with Christians, with Jews, with non-Muslims. This is their underlying tenet. So, you know, talking about giving them a piece of this and a piece of that, and we'll stop building the kitchen and the porch and all that, is meaningless talk, because the underlying fact is, in all their textbooks, their picture of Palestine is the entire state of Israel. It's not a section here and a section. It's the entire state of Israel. When they clean up their textbooks, when they stop putting out all that incitement, when they stop training their suicide bombers and this sort of thing, then we can start to talk about peace. But peace doesn't mean giving away the land of Israel. It means acknowledging that people can live together.
Right. Which really brings us to the point that the peace has actually been counterproductive.
The Oslo accords were counterproductive.